Unit 2, The Characters of Shakespeare.
In Shakespeare's vast and colorful gallery of several hundred characters, merchants, peasants, shepherds, clowns, tinkers, weavers, wrestlers, soldiers mingle with priests, courtiers, generals, and kings. But king as well as commoner, many a Shakespearean character has so fired the popular imagination that his name has become a byword for a type of personality, a symbol of conflict, or an example of some human drive or emotion. Among these are such designations as a Romeo, a Shylock, a Falstaff, a Lear.
But rich and varied as Shakespeare's characters are, many of them are cut from the same cloth, stamped from the same die. Certain types and certain patterns of action appear and reappear in his plays.
There is the stern but just Duke, vigorous in carrying out the laws of his realm, but often capable of mercy and kindness when circumstances warrant. In the Comedy of Errors, the Duke of Ephesus reprieves from death the old merchant Aegean, father of the twins involved in the mix-up.
There is the friendly friar, helper, counselor, and confidant of many of the leading characters. In Romeo and Juliet, a friar named Lawrence plays a vital role, listening to the young couple, counseling and protecting them, and secretly marrying them. Later, however, trying to save their marriage by having Juliet pretend to commit suicide by taking poison, he learns to his horror that his plans have gone tragically awry.
Another type fairly common in Shakespeare's plays is the woman forced to masquerade as a man. Among these are Julia in The Two Gentlemen of Verona, Portia in The Merchant of Venice, Rosalind in As You Like It, and Viola in Twelfth Night.
In Cymbeline, the innocent Imogene assumes male attire to escape danger threatening from three directions, her husband, the queen, and the queen's son, Cloten. But it takes all the servant's power to induce her to do so, so aghast is she at her husband's plot to kill her because of her suspected infidelity. Having lost the will to live, she pleads with Pisanio the servant to carry out his orders to kill her.
Look, I draw the sword myself. Take it and hit the innocent mansion of my love, my heart. Fear not, 'tis empty of all things but grief. Prithee, dispatch. The lamb entreats the butcher. Where's thy knife? Thou art too slow to do thy master's bidding when I desire it too.
Other heroines of Shakespeare, wives, sweethearts, mothers, are also falsely suspected, driven into exile or cast into prison, and forced to plead their innocence from a foreign land or a jail cell. In Much Ado About Nothing, Hero, falsely accused and abandoned by her lover Claudio, remains in hiding until she can clear her name. With the help of a friar named Francis, a false report of her death is circulated to aid her cause. In The Winter's Tale, the same pattern is repeated. The queen, Hermione, also wrongly suspected of infidelity by her husband, King Leontes, adopts a similar stratagem. She then remains concealed for 16 years after her supposed death.
Yes, Shakespeare's women do not have an easy time of it. Another type that suffers harshly at the hands of men is the rejected woman, cast aside by her faithless lover for another. In this class are Mariana, who loves the Duke's evil deputy, Angelo, in the play Measure for Measure, but is spurned by him for Isabella. Julia, neglected by the false Proteus in The Two Gentlemen of Verona, and the devoted Helena, disdained by Count Bertram in All's Well That Ends Well. Impatient to be rid of her and to hurry off to the wars, Bertram cries to Paroles, his follower.
I'll send her to my house, acquaint my mother with my hate to her and wherefore I am fled. Write to the king that which I durst not speak. War is no strife to the dark house and the detested wife.
Yet Mariana and Helena have the last word. Shakespeare has them substitute for their rivals, to trick the very men who spurn them. Mariana pretends to be Isabella and traps Angelo. Helena substitutes for Diana and wins back Bertram.
These women undergo much hardship and suffering. But in the romantic tradition, Shakespeare nobly brings all the estranged couples together at the end of each play.
Shakespeare not only pits sweetheart against lover, husband against wife, he also portrays members of the same family in bitter opposition to one another. He pictures daughters against fathers in King Lear and The Merchant of Venice, son against mother in Hamlet, son against father in the subplot of Lear, uncle against niece in As You Like It, as well as other close kin in Distinct Hostility. Here is such a set of characters arrayed in conflict against each other. Do you recognize the relationship?
Prospero versus Antonio in The Tempest. Edgar versus Edmund in King Lear. Claudius versus Hamlet's father in Hamlet. Duke Senior versus Duke Frederick in As You Like It. Orlando versus Oliver in the same play.
Were you able to identify them? They are all brothers, each locked in a keen struggle against the other for high stakes, money, fame, the love of a woman, and other reasons. In each of these plots, Shakespeare presents not only fraternal conflict, but also a sharply etched ethical situation, good arrayed against evil, and then proceeds to show us the consequences of that struggle. Yet so strong is hope and the power of the human spirit, even in calamity, that Duke Senior still can find some good in misfortune.
Now, my co-mates and brothers in exile, hath not old custom made this life more sweet than that of painted pomp? Are not these woods more free from peril than the envious court? Sweet are the uses of adversity, which, like the toad, ugly and venomous, wears yet a precious jewel in his head. And this our life, exempt from public haunt, finds tongues in trees, books in the running brooks, sermons in stones, and good in everything. I would not change it.
Closely associated with many of these characters is another group, liberally interspersed among Shakespeare's plays, personalities who do much to invigorate and enliven the proceedings. These are the comic figures, the clowns, the servants, the tinkers, the schoolmasters, the barmaids, the curates, the constables, the soldiers of fortune headed by the roistering Falstaff, and a host of others. What is the essence of Shakespeare's comic art? The ability to view his characters dispassionately, to treat them good-humoredly, to temper ridicule with good nature and sympathy, to blend disparagement with affection. Most of all, it is Shakespeare's capacity to view life whole, to see pathos in the comic and humor even in the midst of tragedy. The scatterbrained nurse in Romeo and Juliet, the pompous Polonius in Hamlet, the nimble-witted Falstaff in King Henry IV.
But there is pure comedy, too. Humor for the sake of humor. Here are some of the moments of high mirth and fun. Do you recognize the participants?
If this fall into thy hands, revolve. In my stars I am above thee. But be not afraid of greatness. Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. She thus advises thee that sighs for thee. Remember who commended thy yellow stockings and wished to see thee ever cross-gartered. If thou entertain'st my love, let it appear in thy smiling. Thy smile becomes becomes thee well. Therefore, in my presence, still smile. Dear, my sweet, I prithee.
This is Malvolio, priggish steward to the Lady Olivia in Twelfth Night, reading aloud an anonymous love letter which he believes the lady herself has addressed to him. But the real authors of the letter, who have contrived this hoax, are in hiding, watching his every reaction in great merriment. But courtship has other comic facets. Here is love shown in humorous conflict.
I had rather hear my dog bark at a crow than a man swear he loves me.
God keep your ladyship still in that mind, so some gentleman or other shall scape a predestinate scratched face.
Scratching could not make it worse, and 'twere such a face as yours were.
This is the high-spirited pair, Beatrice and Benedick, in Much Ado About Nothing, parrying witty insults in a pretended feud, which is really a courtship.
Included in the gallery of comic characters are other memorable figures. There is Nick Bottom the Weaver in A Midsummer Night's Dream, who has been wandering enchanted in the woods with an ass's head affixed to his ears, suddenly waking and shouting,
I have had a most rare vision. I have had a dream, past the wit of man to say what dream it was. A man is but an ass if he go about to expound this dream. Methought I was, there is no man can tell what. Methought I was, and methought I had, but man is but a patched fool if he will offer to say what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard, the ear of man hath not seen. Man's hand is not able to taste, his tongue to conceive, nor his heart to report what my dream was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream, and it shall be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom.
There is Touchstone, the court clown, who follows Rosalind and Celia into exile in the Forest of Arden. Touchstone, the true natural philosopher, who can view himself as well as the other characters with complete detachment and wit. He can also say of mankind,
oh, sir, we quarrel in print by the book, as you have books for good manners. I will name you the degrees. The first, the retort courteous, the second, the quip modest, the third, the reply churlish, the fourth, the reproof valiant, the fifth, the countercheck quarrelsome, the sixth, the lie with circumstance, the seventh, the lie direct. All these you may avoid, but the lie direct, and you may avoid that too with an if. Your if is the only peacemaker. Much virtue in if.
There are the clownish gravediggers of Hamlet with their grisly humor, enlivening for a brief moment the grim and inexorable march of events. What mordant wit lies in the first gravedigger's sally to his comrade?
In good faith, the gallows does well. But how does it well? It does well to those that do ill. And when you are asked the question next, who builds stronger than a mason, a shipwright, or a carpenter? Say, a grave maker. The houses he makes last till doomsday.
And in King Henry IV, there is that immortal rogue Sir John Falstaff, the symbol of riotous merriment, perhaps the most comic of all Shakespeare's creations. It is he whose antics must surely have split the ears of the groundlings in the Elizabethan theater. Companion and counselor to the prince in Hal's dissolute youth, Falstaff is boastful, lying, sensual, cowardly, and corrupt. Yet though the prince shares in Falstaff's escapades, he merely tolerates them, never gives them his personal sanction, and in time outgrows them, and sheds his fast-drinking companion, who dies of a broken heart.
Inhabiting Shakespeare's fanciful world, too, are the characters of the supernatural. On the one hand roam the bright spirits. Gay Ariel, Prospero's faithful helper in the tempest, singing from his favorite nook.
Where the bee sucks, there suck I. In a cowslip's bell I lie. There I couch when owls do cry. On the bat's back I do fly after summer merrily. Merrily, merrily shall I live now under the blossom that hangs on the bough.
Frolicsome Puck in A Midsummer Night's Dream, fleet emissary of Oberon, the fairy king.
I go, look how I go. Swifter than arrow from the Tartar's bow.
playful Oberon, his jealous master, plotting to humble his fairy queen.
And with the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies.
On the other hand, lurk the creatures of the dark. There are the babbling witches of Macbeth and the slain Banquo. There are the fearsome spirits of Hamlet's father and the murdered Julius Caesar. Restless ghosts stir in Cymbeline when the dead of Posthumus' family plead with Jupiter to help their suffering son. And the ghosts of Richard III's murdered victims appear to him in a dream to fill the wretched king's night with torment.
Shakespeare utilizes them all, blending the natural with the supernatural, to unfold his great themes, love, jealousy, ambition, courage, mercy, justice. It is these that we shall now consider.